Welcome back and thank you very much for your time. The Finder newspaper says road crashes, 393 killed in 2 months. Motorcycles alone killed 139 commuters. 29 persons burned to death in a Kintampo-Tamale highway clash. Pone residents in Demo against landfill site. And Speaker urges media to engage experts on national discourse. The Daily Guide. 31 perish in Kintampo crash. Samira speaks out on insults. Auditor General grabs 350,000 Ghana cedis from Get Fund. And medical fella wedding, soldiers detained. The Daily Graphic, 70 years and strong. Graphic 70th anniversary launch aim at autonomy. Speaker tells SOEs, that state-owned enterprises. And great reunion at Graphic 70th anniversary launch. Collision leaves 31 dead, 29 burnt beyond recognition. The Ghanaian Times. Two cops in police grip over missing service rifle. Allow EC to compile new voters register. Declining crude prices on international market. NDC COPEC calls for reduction in fuel prices. Stories on page 18 and 28. Four now arrested in connection with murder of the Sogakope assemblyman. 35 burnt to death in ghastly road crash on the Kintampo-Tamale Highway. And Ghana Health Service seeks development partners' support to upscale e-tracker project. And the GTA declares Regal Hotel best in the Northern Region. Congratulations to them. My guest this morning is the Honourable Member of Parliament for the Legikuku constituency, who is preparing for his primaries on the 25th of April. Honourable Dr. Bernard Okoboy is also the board chair for the Kolebu Teaching Hospital. Doc, welcome. Thank you very much for your time.
Yeah, my brother. Johnny.
And lawyer Eduji Tamaklu is a member of the NDC's legal and communication team. General, welcome. How are you
good
doing,
morning.
Counsel? Corona.
No, you didn't. Then we may as well be using our legs now.
Okay. Okay.
Understand that the
I saw Vice President Mike Pence do that.
Like this.
Yeah. So we're Corona. Doc, you didn't bring the sanitizer today.
Yeah. I mean,
local content.
When I brought it last time, the opposition abused it, so I've kept it in my car.
The opposition
abused it. I was thinking that because the disease is colorblind, irrespective of opposition, my brother here will be magnanimous enough to exchange those goodies.
We'll supply them at half the price.
Anyway.
But there have been this claim that globally, you note that a lot of presidents are basically going through what you call the self-quarantine, where they are imposing 21 days and 10 on their own. My thinking was that having regards to the most recent travels by our president, I mean, it was just right, you know, and Doc will recommend that.
But if it was cleared at the airport?
We have no indication as to that clearance.
Okay.
That's just the point. But, and you know, one of the things that you should be worried relates to how close we are with people. As we speak, there was this Republican function very recently. Where some top Republican politicians attended. Today, as we speak, a lot of these Republican politicians have, you know, been placed under some self-quarantine. But we'll see how it pans out.
I've seen the Catholic Church and the Anglican Church.
In fact, the whole of Italy today is under a lockdown.
Wow.
Yeah.
I've seen the Catholic Church and Anglican Church in Ghana. I don't know about other places. Telling their priests, for example, you know, they use one cup for their communion, and telling them to stop that while this is surging and use intinction or accept communion by hand and avoid handshakes and hugs, just bow to each other and all of that. But, Doc, should the president have been self-quarantined following his many travels?
Yeah, so forgive me, but first of all, let me say a very good morning to all your viewers. And do some small. This is the protocol, more or less, document guiding the strategy in the UK.
Okay.
And I'll read.
On COVID 2019.
Yes.
Okay.
And I'll read paragraph 2.5. As it is a new virus, the lack of immunity in the population and the absence as yet of an effective vaccine
means
that COVID-19 has the potential to spread extensively. The current data seem to show that we are all susceptible to catching this disease. And thus, it's also more likely than not that the UK will be significantly affected. Among those, this is the part very important. Okay. Among those who become infected, some will exhibit no symptoms. Early data suggests that of those who develop an illness, the great majority will have a mild to moderate but self-limiting illness. When we say self-limiting, it means it resolves on its own.
Okay.
It starts and then the curve goes down.
Okay.
Similar to seasonal flu. You understand? It is, however, also clear that a minority of the people who get COVID-19 will develop complications such as severe cough to require hospital care. Most often pneumonia, that's chest infection.
Right.
In a small proportion of these, the illness may be severe enough to lead to death. So far, the data we have suggests that the risk of severe disease and death increases amongst elderly people and in people with underlying health conditions. Illness is less common and usually less severe in younger adults.
Okay.
Now, so the point I want to make is that there is the other story of COVID that we are not told.
Okay.
It's a virus similar to many viruses that cause common cold. There are two things that makes this corona exciting or notorious.
Okay.
First of all, it's a new strain. And in the scientific community, all viruses have been itemized or listed.
Okay.
They are known.
Okay.
Technology allows you to split a virus into its components and know the makeup.
Okay.
That is made up of less than 100 proteins.
Right.
So if you have another virus which is isolated, qualifies to be in the family of corona, but has a makeup which is not on the table or listed in the lab, then it's a new one.
It's a new one, okay.
And the excitement is for two reasons. It means when you get it, there's no immediate vaccine available.
So then it can spread faster.
It can spread faster. But one thing, and more importantly, immunity is not in the population. Most of the viruses, a lot of us have immunity. Yeah. You'll be exposed on and off. So in your system, when they come, your body deals with them.
Common cough, cold
and all that. Influenza viruses, adenoviruses, even most of the corona, the common cold we get, most are caused by corona, but not this one.
Okay.
Exactly. Now, if 1,000 people come into contact with corona, it doesn't mean all of them will show it in their blood when they even come into contact. Assuming corona falls in your hand today and you take it to your nostrils. It's not automatic that if you are 1,000 of you, you fall ill. Usually, you can have, let's say, about infection is about, let's say, 10%. Okay. You can have about 100 people having it in their blood when you check in the lab. And out of the 100, it can be about 5 or 6 who present with
symptoms and all.
Exactly.
Okay.
So these are things we must know so that in as much as we educate people to be careful, we don't paint a doomsday picture.
Okay.
Now, let me use this opportunity to make a clarification. In Parliament and on a media station over the weekend, I mentioned that in this country, we've been able to manage a case of Ebola.
Right.
Now, the checks I've made because of some of my partners, the call, is that what we had is a hemorrhagic fever. Ebola is a hemorrhagic fever.
Okay.
Hemorrhagic fever means that you have a fever with some bleeding of a sort.
Okay.
Either you have vomiting blood or there's blood from your nostrils.
Okay.
So the case we had in Tema General was a hemorrhagic fever. The laboratory results mentioned Lassa fever, which also presents like Ebola. It's also a hemorrhagic fever.
Okay.
It was positive in Ghana. But when we sent a sample to CDC in the States, it came back negative.
Okay.
So more or less, officially on our records, we didn't have any of them. But we had a suspected case of a hemorrhagic fever. And I mean, those days, some of the differentials mean the things we were thinking of.
Okay.
Ebola was also one of them, because that was the Ebola window.
Right.
And the patient had traveled from countries that had Ebola cases.
Okay. So you were suspecting that?
Yes. So just to make the clarification, that what Ghana had was a hemorrhagic fever.
Okay.
And confirmed, had Lassa, but later
who is leading our charge? I mean, if you go to the U.S., Vice President Mike Pence is leading the charge. Donald Trump announced him. You are quoting the protocol from the U.K. What are we doing? Who is leading
Ghana,
our charge?
In Ghana,
who is the single figure championing it?
In Ghana, there is a national technical coordinating committee, which also has the regional teams and even the district. It's been scaled up. I think the district is still on good, but for the national and regional team, they've they've worked around. Yesterday, I called my CEO 2-3 times during the day. He couldn't pick.
Asare
was in the meeting, the team. He's part of the regional team.
Okay.
Meeting. They meet every day. Since Corona broke, every single day, they meet to look at cases, suspected cases, the approach, how it can be reviewed. You know, surveillance, you continue to revise your thing. So we also have a team.
Can we have one figure?
I start to be corrected.
Okay.
But the last time I checked, I think the person who was key in leading the team was Dr. Isaiah Sari.
Okay, the at the presidency.
Yes, at the presidency. And the DG also.
Okay.
But the minister...
Dr. Pashoka Bwake.
Yes, but the minister sits as the chairman of the coordination.
Okay.
Yes, the last time I checked.
Okay.
Yeah. So we have a team that's working. And you see, you ask about... you talk about the president's quarantine.
Right.
So I did a little reading from the strategies. There are 4 strategies you can approach.
Okay.
Countries are approaching are taking different approaches. You can take the prevention and reduction of spread approach, which is what Ghana has taken. And apparently, countries which are not endowed like the first world normally take this.
Take that.
So what you do is that you try to either close all your boundaries so that you don't get cases coming in.
Okay.
But that one has a lot of repercussions on economy.
Mm.
So countries rather will take temperatures at the border.
Border. Okay.
To make sure that if you have a high temperature, you are quarantined to see whether you have corona or not. So that's what we are doing here. And then, assuming you have corona or a suspected case, you are kept at one place. Okay. That's to prevent contagion or spread.
Okay, spread.
So this is the first approach. The UK and US are doing the other ones, which is self-reporting.
Okay.
So when a plane is going to the UK, they will not take anybody's temperature, but they require the airline to give them a clearance that everybody was well 1 hour before sitting the plane.
Okay.
And so they take what they have a term for the list of all people in the plane.
Okay.
They have the
manifest.
Yes. Okay. So the manifest will tell them that these people are okay. No temperature is taken.
Mm.
Now, assuming, and they do self-reporting. So when you enter and you start getting unwell, you report yourself. You call that I'm not well.
I saw a statement from the Ghana Health Service that says report yourself.
Yeah.
But then the key question will be that, look, we're asking people to report. It's impossible for us to close all our borders because they are porous and all of that. Yes. I had a report from the airport, for example, that says that you are a doctor.
Yeah.
To do one procedure on, for example, Eduji, you use one glove, check him. Yeah. When you're done, you take it off, toss it in the bin, pick another one for a new. But you find one person wearing the gloves and touching literally everybody.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's not proper, is it?
So let me say quickly that we are using a prevention and reduction of spread.
Mm.
The UK is doing what they call education and evacuation.
Okay.
So UK would evacuate people even from Wuhan and bring them to a facility and quarantine them because that's the strategy they've adopted. Okay. We have included some parts of the UK one which includes quarantine people because we admit that our borders are what, porous.
Okay.
So some can see. Now, the one you are referring to, if I'm dealing with people here today, you know I'm without gloves, I can decide to wear gloves. It only reduces my rate of picking organisms for any of you. But I can use the gloves from one person to the other because none of you is, I'm not dealing with a suspected case.
Okay.
I don't know where they get it.
Mm.
So if anybody shows up with high temperature in the airport, everything that they will use on that person with the travel history of having gone to China would be discarded.
But given the fact that this virus stays within you for 14 days until it starts manifesting, is it not advisable that we...
Yeah. So you don't want to go the other level.
Because if, for example, touch with the DG has it,
yeah.
and you touch him with the gloves and you touch me, means that you have infected me against my will.
Absolutely. If you take that approach, you are in trouble. What it means is that every single person that approaches a hospital in this country, we must go in the full gear. Because if you had an emergency where he came with a fracture, it's possible he has not shown yet. So everybody, but what makes it, the reason why the scientists will not recommend this is that, like I said, when 1,000 people get exposed to the virus, it's not everyone that comes down with an illness.
Okay.
For even those who have the virus in their blood, the few, they will not show physical illness.
Okay, thank you. Did you step in for me? This is what doctor is saying.
And I need to thank him for the education. And that's precisely because that's his field. And so he comes with that rich knowledge.
Mm.
And also remember that he has also worked in a typical rural area.
Mm.
So in terms of deployment of medical emergencies, he has a better appreciation of this event. Again, our prayer is that the approach in resolving this must be more scientific, so that at all material times, the fear, panic situation. Look, if today there is news that even our doctors have discovered even one person having it in this country, you can imagine the fear and panic that is going to create. And so maybe going forward, we should all be vigilant. Okay. I've heard commentaries to the effect that we should focus more on personal hygiene and related matters. And that is why they have recommended the fact that the use of hand sanitizers and others. Right. We are basically a touching society.
Right.
We basically do. Friendships are demonstrated by hugs, handshakes, and all of those things. So maybe going forward, we may just have to find a way to deal with this matter. As for the devastating effect of the coronavirus, we are still counting it.
Okay. So, Doc, quick one. Is the authority thinking about, for example, sending out a directive for institutions, schools, to have Veronica buckets, hand sanitizers, at least as part of, you know, sipping it into the minds of people? Are we thinking of that?
I think we have very basic protocols. In fact, what we refer to as case definition. So, most departments, in fact, in almost every hospital. I was in Lekuma Hospital last week.
Okay.
Consulting room, six. And it was right in front of me. Think corona when you see the following.
Right.
One, a patient who's traveled to any of the following countries, China, this, that. The second one, if the temperature is high, above 37.5, if he has any respiratory symptom. Then contact the team for appropriate clothing and all that. So these things are being done. And you see, for Christ, our health system is not, in quote, a useless one.
Okay.
We have, even before corona came, in most units in Kolebuda, when you have the alcohol, the sanitizer. You also have the, at the emergency, everywhere you have these Veronica buckets or even sink and all that. You see, the hand washing that is being referred to is the single most important intervention in reducing nosocomial infection, that's hospital acquired infections.
Okay.
Once it was discovered through a particular research they did many years ago, one of the early researches, they compared two wards and just put items for washing of hands at the entrance of one and left the other. Infection rates in the one with the hand washing mechanism reduced by close to 40%.
Okay.
So generally, any virus or pathogen, any disease causing that comes out, the first advice you give generally is that wash your hands.
Okay.
Because the hand is the vehicle that picks things from one person to the other. So we've been doing hand washing. But this only drives home the point that do it regularly. And you know, most people go to funerals. We come home, you greet a lot of people.
From the morgue,
from church, we go to church. You know, people use water.
Yes, just water.
Just water. And about you, when you use water.
Actually, in one bucket.
In fact, when you even use water, you've even made the organisms more viable now. Because water as a medium is prevented by some organisms. Better than air, because air is fluid, air moves, so it can even displace the organism.
Right.
So water without soap is a killer.
It's dangerous.
You know, and whenever you ask friends, I tell friends, oh, let's add some soap. Oh, this your doctor things, this your doctor things. So
you know, curiously, in our part of the world, is after you are done eating.
You eat the germs and then you wash the oil off with water, with soap.
So hand washing is a skill. You must speak. If you should practice, it helps in many things.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's go to page 28 of the Ghanaian Times. It says COPEC demands reduction in fuel prices as global crude prices drop again. The chairman of the Petroleum Consumers wants oil marketing companies in the country to reduce the ex-pump prices for consumers to reflect a sustained decline in the global crude oil prices. According to COPEC, consumers could be benefiting from a reduction between 10% to 32% compared to the 2% that the consumers have been given over the past few weeks. portions of a statement by COPEC, which cited this nearly 30% decline in the global oil prices, and say it's expectation in the coming few coming days that the various oil marketing companies and the BDCs will reduce, ensure that Ghanaians are giving nothing but the full benefit of these sustained reductions in the fuel prices on the international market. They also quote the, if you like, the stability of the CDI at this point, and the prices that are reducing on the global market from some 55.85 to $5.40, and they're saying that, look, reduce the fuel prices because you're pinching us. They are asking for between 10% and 32%. The NDC is, yesterday, if I heard them right, we're asking for 20% or reduction. Doc, let me start this with you. Is this a good call that because global prices are reducing, the CD, we say, have become stable, reduce the price? Why are you giving 2%?
John, yesterday, did you guys do the International Women's Day?
Yeah, we did.
Oh, okay. All
right. We did extensively.
Wow.
Yeah.
So let me take the opportunity to celebrate all our women and girls, and to thank especially the First Lady. Mm. She supports me a lot in managing the constituency. Mm. The Chief of Staff, Madame Frimal Pari, I think the highest appointee, female appointee. Mm. She's also very supportive. And then Samaria, Mrs. Baumia.
Okay.
And all ladies. My mother is passed. Mm. But I say all the time that had it not been for my mother, maybe I would have been doing something funny on the streets. Mm-hmm. I was raised at a critical stage in my life beyond secondary school by my mom alone.
Okay.
And I schooled throughout pre-sec on loans. Mm. And I don't remember having gotten a textbook bought for me before. Mm. All I had to pitch.
You had to borrow.
With my friends.
You know, the sharks, usually, we used to borrow and then we would learn it and do small notes and pass it on to the rich kids who had.
Yes.
And by the grace of photocopy.
Yes. You either photocopy or the rich kids get it, but they don't like to read.
Yes.
So you will read and do a summary of two, three pages and give it to them.
I had some few friends whose parents could afford the books. So, and luckily for me, I padded them to the extent of going to the houses so I could read all the way there. So, look, one thing I've realized is that it is so true. When you raise a woman and she becomes learned, she raises many generations, countries. I tell people, and it's very powerful, it is not strange to meet a boy or a girl who is not educated and yet has a father who is learned. Mm. But it is difficult to come across a child whose mother is educated and shows symptoms of not being civilized or not being read. Are you getting the scenario?
I get it.
Training a man or educating a man is not a guarantee that his children will become educated. But when the woman is learned, her children become learned as
Dr.
well.
Dr. Elgree said that.
Yes, okay. And watch it. Most brilliant students you meet, their parents, especially their mothers, happen to be teachers. I don't want to start mentioning them yet.
Okay.
But greetings to Chief Vanda. What is his name?
Apak?
Chief, yes, Chief Magas. Greetings to him. And the Honorable Jogate.
Okay.
My
basic concern is that while we try to socialize the girls and to encourage them, we must socialize the boys as well.
The boys are not being left behind.
So that, I'm saying this, look.
No, but you see, Johnny, I think that
the boys are
even by reason of societal and cultural structures, already the female is already disadvantaged.
Yeah.
And so I always, and because I'm a father of two girls, so my preference always, I'm a bit biased now.
Mm-hmm.
And the bias is because already you have to work hard to break the glass ceiling. And you need to do double that. Mm-hmm. And like he pointed out, once you have a mother who is keen on education, you can always be sure of the very best. We never had the opportunity to wish our women well on the International Women's Day. We will continue to do. Our politics is said that you cannot do it effectively without the female population. And that is why for us, in all the manifestos that we've had, for God knows how many years, we have always put the woman at the very center of our manifesto.
Thank you. Doc, respond to COPEC says between 10 and 32%.
Yeah, so
NDCA says 20% because global prices have dropped. Yeah. CD is relatively stable.
Yes, absolutely.
Why are we not reducing?
Yeah, absolutely. I think in on the 1st of July 2015, this country decided to deregulate the petroleum pricing regime.
Right.
What it meant was that when prices go up on the international market, all things being equal locally, the prices here also ought to reflect what is happening outside. And when they go down, all things being equal. I say all things being equal because there are local factors that also influence the price,
right,
like inflation. If you have inflation rates in double digits going to maybe 15, 17, 18, it will affect your prices even if world prices are standard.
Now we have a single digit inflation.
Exactly, yeah. So that call is a legitimate one. It has a lot of reason behind, but my my checks and so on, this research I've done shows that the pricing is not done on a daily basis.
Okay.
So what they do is that they take average, I think bi-weekly, of the prices, strike the average, and then factor it into the formula.
Okay.
They have what they refer to as, I think, the pricing indications, but not pricing indications.
A certain formula. That
yes, yes. And for now, for the sake of our viewers, you have the National Petroleum Authority serving as a regulator, making sure that consumers are treated well as we get value for money, and at the same time acting in a way that will not collapse the OMCs, that's the oil marketing oil marketing companies, who actually sell these petroleum products. What I've come across is that you've had a drop on the prices of fuel, something about 16% in the first window of January 2020.
They're saying 2% so far.
Yeah, I mean, dated Brent in the first window of January from my... they have different types of the petroleum product, but dated Brent, for example, fell by about 16% in the first window of January 2020. Now, I have been reliably informed that they had some very low... They had some windows with very low margins. Margins meaning that they are supposed normally to make, let's say, more than 60... pesos per liter, unless a petrol, but they went as low as below 40, especially somewhere in November. Diesel went even below 20. So apparently, some of these, because of these low margins, the OMCs didn't transfer the prices. They had low margins because when prices were supposed to go up, they didn't translate it to the consumer. So they are using this to do some recoveries. But the good news or the refreshing news is that the next window starts 16th of March, and I'm told that the petroleum prices that will be used is the one that COPEC and others are referring to. So that one would have reduced by between 15 to 20%, reduced as in terms of the prices that will be used, but I don't know the impact to have on the final.
The NDC, for example, says anything short of 20% should be rejected by the Ghanaian people.
I mean we've also been in opposition before, you know, some of these things. I mean, I don't think they won't benefit the Ghanaian. They'll pitch for the lowest end. You understand? But like I said, I know there will be reduction in price in the next window. The extent, I can't tell. And for the opposition, why not? I mean,
this next window is when?
It starts 16th of March.
That's sometime next week.
Yes, yes, yes.
Prices will drop. Yes, but you don't know the percentage by which.
Yes, I don't know the percentage. All I know is that the prices that will be used, the price that they will pay for the formula of the petrol, the petrol price has dropped by over 15%.
Okay.
But I don't know whether it will correlate directly to 15% reduction in the final price you pay. But I know that it's going to drop.
The COPEC also is asking for the price stabilization and recovery levy to be scrapped because they think that we can find more resourceful means of funding, you know, so that it doesn't increase our pump prices and allow. So if I drive to the fuel station now, I'm not thinking about some levy that will increase
I think the, you see, government, especially this government, is acts with a lot of inertia when it comes to introducing new taxes. We, as much as possible, we don't want to introduce new taxes because of the ramifications, the multiple ramifications. And so, Johnny, usually when you have a particular levy, which had been in existence or is in existence already, You understand? Mm-hmm. Especially because you don't want to introduce new ones. You know, you normally want to get enough solid reasons before removing and I've heard those arguments before, mm-hmm. that the time when you introduce a stabilization, it was for a purpose. That purpose is no more, so we should take it away. I suspect government is looking at the fiscal impact, mm-hmm. of removing fiscal, as in how it will disorient, right. your program.
You have deregulation, yeah. and they say, for example, that's deceptive because if you say you have a stabilization module or levy and that's running, you have, yeah. deregulation, you have this, you have that, plenty of things in there.
Yeah, Johnny,
that
I
is increasing the prices.
I grant them their debate or issues with the existence of that levy, mm. because the purpose it served, like they claim, is not there anymore. Mm. But like I said, and Duji is aware, when you are managing an economy, usually things are not in an isolation. Mm. Anytime you withdraw, pick out a particular, you pluck out a particular inflow, mm. it has an impact, what you refer to as the fiscal impact.
Okay.
How it disorients your whole program. And I'm sure maybe going forward, the more we take a critical look at that argument, the more maybe there could be the chance for it to be taken out.
Is the government being insensitive? That's what the NDC is alleging. Oh. While you were in opposition, yeah. your presidential candidate, now president of the Republic, yeah. had cause to criticize yeah. the Mahama-led administration of yeah. being insensitive yeah. because fuel prices were going up and your promise was to bring it down.
Yeah.
Knowing full well that the conditions that will allow yeah. for a reduction are not only determined from here, but yeah. from outside. Yeah. Are you being insensitive?
Yeah. So you realize immediately that I said the claims they are making are legitimate, because that's what we're also making.
Are you being insensitive?
No. We've said in the next window prices are likely to come down based on the calculations. The only small information is that they are not reviewed daily. Okay. That's what our people must have. They are done in windows, a period. So if I start working with a $60 per barrel and the price falls within that window to 40, I can't review the $60 within that window unless I go into the next window.
Okay, yes. Thank you. Eduji, step in for me. Why are you making the government look bad? Someone would ask that you know that there's a window.
May I start first by reading a tweet by Dr. Mahamudu Bawumia somewhere May 2015. And so, yes, so I'm always on his Twitter handle, just to, especially within 2015, 2016, okay. the things he said. This is what he says. I feel sad this morning for the ordinary Ghanaian, the hardworking people who have to endure the insensitive decision to increase fuel prices at this time. He proceeds, by 3rd day of December 2015, Dr. Mahamudu Bawumia had this to say to the taxi and trotter driver who had been hit by high cost of fuel and insurance, you have a chance to vote for change. And Nanado Dankwa Akufo-Addo himself made the point that the cost of living and the cost of fuel is the highest in Ghana today, unquote. Mm. Now, having said this, if you look at the fact that from 2017 January to date, the insensitive, corrupt MPP administration had raised or increased petroleum prices 25 times, to the extent that fuel prices had to jump from 14, 15, 16 Ghana cedis to 25 Ghana cedis today. In fact, if there is any one item that affects all of us, rich, poor, or what have you, it is the price of crude and the price of petroleum products. And so when the opportunity came, the price war between Saudi Arabia and Russia, which today had reduced the global price of crude oil by 30%. Mm. Our expectation is that government, without delay, would reduce the price that we pay at the pump, if not by the same commensurate level, by a lower percentage. And we are even more magnanimous to government. We are saying that a 20% reduction, so that today we should be buying petrol at least 19 Ghana cedis. That would be fair.
There are local factors.
And you see, it's good you ask the question, what has been the posturing of the MPP? Mm. The MPP, with the greatest respect, have always done politics with crude prices. And I recall how in the year 2000, the likes, may his soul rest in peace, G.H. Mensah and others, mounted political platforms with gallons of petrol, and they will ask Ghanaian, petrol mutono say, then they will shout. Even at that time, it was 60 pesos, 0.65. Not by the time the NPP left office, they had increased petroleum prices to the highest in the history of this country. And we have continued in that trajectory. We have always believed that governance requires that we make receipts, petroleum receipts, you know, taxes and other. Even when we introduced ESLA, you recall how the NPP bastardized ESLA, called it nuisance taxes, and that with the benefit of power, they were going to scrap ESLA among other things. You know, today, as we speak, ESLA alone had given this administration over 8 billion Ghana cedis. 8 billion. And we are still counting. What have they used all those proceeds for? They are not accounting
to
anybody.
They pay the BDCs.
As for that, it's just a fraction of it. You understand. But the point we are making this morning is that we have a glorious opportunity to reduce the price of petroleum products so that the good people of this country would have the benefit of enjoying lower prices.
It's 20 cedis, not too much to ask for.
But you see, the thing is that there are two principal, you know, determinants. The forex, that's the foreign exchange, and the price of crude oil generally. Today, we, by reason of the coronavirus, we are not importing a lot of the things we do from China. Today, our brothers and sisters at Okaichi, that's the Guta, are even complaining that we may be running out of, you know, short of essential facilities or essential, you know, commodity that we use in various households, simply because now we're unable to go to China to bring these items. And once it happened, the downward pressure on the city is taken
off.
You
don't want to give the Bank of Ghana credit for selling forex ahead. There's a 40-member committee who is looking at how to look at the FX development.
The Bank of Ghana has demonstrated beyond doubt, especially under Addison and Dr. Mahmoud Bawumia, that they have no clue relative to stabilizing the
city. They're selling forex ahead.
As we
speak, that's good for us.
As we speak, we do know that what is sustaining the city, is keeping the city in check, is the result of our inability to import items from China.
Nigeria should have been the biggest beneficiary then.
They are benefiting.
Because Nigeria is bigger than you.
No, but they are benefiting. There is no doubt at all that today our trade volumes between Ghana and China had reduced significantly because our people are unable to go to China. That's a fact.
Okay, so that's the first leg. What's the second leg?
The second leg had to do with the pricing of, you know, the crude oil price globally. And by reason of this war between Saudi Arabia and Russia, we are where we are. So the two principal determinants of the price of crude oil are favorable to this administration. And that is why we are saying that our call for the reduction in petroleum prices is legitimate and well-founded.
It says it's the 16th of March. That's where the next window is due, and you will see reduction.
I do not think that Ghanaians should be subject to this insensitivity. Again, government has the opportunity today to intervene, to make living conditions better. Because, see, the idea of petroleum price is that immediately there is an increase. It affects everything. When there is a reduction, it's supposed to have the same ripple effect. Today, I am very happy my brother here is with me. The people in Lejokuku are looking at him, that there is a conversation about reducing the price of petroleum products. In this constituency, you have a lot of people who have taxis, trotters, among other things. And they have a huge expectation that together with me, will make a legitimate call on government to this morning announce a reduction in the price of crude. In fact, your cameraman, everybody here, is very expectant. Because before you come here, you have to go through one means of transportation or the other. And so this goes directly to the good people of this country. I have no hesitation at all in making this call on President Ahmadu Dankwa Akufo-Addo, that he has been extremely insensitive to us for the past 3 years This is a glorious opportunity. He should not miss it at all. He should embrace it and immediately announce a reduction.
Are you not just pouring sand into the president's gallery?
Look, I've had that conversation. We in power, okay, went to parliament, announced a certain benchmark value or price for crude oil. Within a twinkle of an eye, crude oil prices fell. There were serious dislocation in terms of our budget, timelines, projects to be undertaken, among other things. Mm. But it never stopped us in appropriate circumstances in reducing. At that time, when we made the call to our brothers that they should come along, because these are matters that you cannot continue to play politics with, they called us incompetent. So they have no opportunity today to cite the same reason why they're unable to reduce petroleum prices. Because, among other things, when we face this kind of crisis, they said no, there are no issues of external factors. Everything boils down to competence or incompetence. So today, if you have these similar situations playing out, it lies not in your mouth to suggest that you'll be given a different treatment. No. We demand immediately a reduction. And that is why we
associate. So you want the reduction to happen today?
Immediately.
Johnny, I think that's why I still hold you as one of my fine hosts on TV. Because you referred him to Nigeria. This Dr. Muazu Ibrahim, when he wrote about corona in the city, about our how the city is doing
well. We are talking about the doctor in UDS that has been helping Dr. Mahmoud Bahmoud.
No, it's not a problem.
He's not coming from an impartial point of view.
It's not,
he's a doctor who only writes to support
No problem.
Okay. I just want that.
Granted, accept that. But these are facts. He said people claim that city is doing well because, and look at this, the following total trade import values in US dollars from this country, South Africa, 17 billion. They are trading with China. Now, Nigeria, 8.3 billion. Ghana is 2.3, less than half Nigeria. Zambia is 1.3. The trend is the same for 2017. Look at this data. Now, if there's anyone who should benefit in terms of their currency doing well, it should be the highest, South Africa, Nigeria. But see what is happening. The data on the exchange rate from November for these countries from 31st December 2019 to 7 February 2020. The data on the exchange rates movements for these countries from 31st December 2019 to 27 February 2020, within which the coronavirus has been occurring, rather shows that the countries that import more from China, we should have seen appreciation of their currencies, are rather depreciating. The data shows that between the period stated above, South African rand moved from 14 to the dollar to 15.4, indicating depreciation. The Zambian kwacha moved from 14.1 to 40.9, indicating depreciation. The Ethiopian bear also moved. Now, Ghana, on the contrary, the Ghana cedi moved from 5.7 per dollar to 5.3, indicating appreciation. Before the corona happened, the cedi had earlier showed signs of appreciation by moving another. Look, it's clear. It comes to better management of the economy. Simple. People are citing corona. The data and the facts have showed you. Other countries with huge trade volumes are even doing worse. They are depreciating. We appreciate it. And that's why Bloomberg scored the city as one of the best people. These are facts. Now, let me say that politics. But
are you happy with the speed? Are you happy with the speed with which the city is appreciating the dollar, the pound?
Johnny,
why? Because on paper, Johnny, by Bloomberg, by everybody, Moody's, we're doing very well.
Yeah.
Even IMF, we're doing well. Yeah. So why is our city not stronger?
Johnny, my point is very simple. We are all politicians. We love this country. There are things that when we see happening, we are happy for everybody.
Some politicians don't love this country.
Okay, all right. You don't let it go there. We love this country. The two of us. Johnny, I know people who are not interested in our politics. One lady called me when the city had this hit and was sort of rose quickly within the short window and said, "Doc, what is happening?" Because she does import. Okay. My point is that when the city is doing well, it has a lot of impact on all of us.
Right.
And we like that. Look, politics, petroleum and politics, may so rest in peace. Prof News, before 2008, before the election, he said when he comes, he will deal with the prices, he will let them come down. And by the way,
which
thanks to...
So
you also did, you admit, which he did. You admit you did politics with petroleum. And you see...
No, I mean, he reduced
Johnny.
The
and then, thanks to, you know, our own... That's our reference point. Sinabaku, He said I should remind NDG that the price of fuel was 18 cities when NDC existed and not 40 as he mentioned. And then, by the way,
good morning to you, Singapore.
I am surprised.
Relax.
Mr. Bakun buys his fuel maybe at the airport airport share.
You see, now guess what?
The price is at Vivo.
See, Johnny, this is the price movement over the past 10 years in terms of percentage for petroleum prices. 2009-2012. 82.7%.
You see, honorable, this morning, the taxi drivers and the allowed to finish this in your conscience, who are watching, are not interested in graphs.
Oh, no, let me end on this note. Proceed. You remember that formula by the Ahoy brothers, the one to show how prices would come down before Kufuor's exit? Charlie, it was an equation in 13 variables. You have the first equation.
That's multiple regression analysis.
You know, so bottom line is that this is a government that is has a lot of inertia, like I said, in increasing prices. We want to stabilize things, and I think largely that's what we are committed to.
Okay.
Thank you.
But just on this same petroleum prices, let nobody attribute the relative stability in the strength of the city to any superior economic management skills. The evidence on record today shows that these governments have demonstrated beyond incompetence when it comes to the management of the city. Beyond the rhetoric, we know, the fact that this administration, even today, is just borrowing to provide what you call, he understands it better, performance enhancing drugs, nandrolone or testosterone. They inject the city with it, and that is what is providing this relative so-called stability. Nothing about superior economic management. Two, you cannot discount the overall effects of the coronavirus in this whole engagement, and that is simply because today our trade volumes with China is at all-time high. And so today, if we're unable to bring items from China, anytime we go to China to buy items, we don't go with cedis. We go with a dollar. You need to go and buy the dollar. So when the pressure on the cedi goes down by reason of the fact that that trade engagement had gone down, it provides the most veritable basis for the relative stability. The point ought to be made very clear that what single policy intervention by government can be attributed to the stability? None. You cannot say, for instance,
you can't see anything.
Why? This is a government, for instance, that today, for the first time in the history of this country, we are having to spend over 20 billion Ghana cedis on debt servicing alone. This is a country, a government that, for the first time in the record of within 3 years, you have borrowed more than any administration in the history of this country. Fact. So when you pick all of this together, especially so, when you are borrowing and there is nothing to show for it, you are borrowing and borrowing and borrowing for consumption. Nothing to show for it. Meanwhile, this is an administration that for the first time in the history of this country, you have revenue, everything, close to 213 billion Ghana cedis. In 8 years, the overall envelope of resources that the NDC had was in the region of 248 billion. But we build infrastructure, we build Ghana gas, we build interchanges, several things. But these guys, with all the money, oil alone, had given them close to 12 billion. What have they to show for?
Thank you.
Free SHS. The overall cost of free SHS. Oh, please. So that I will
thank you. So wrap up.
The overall cost of free SHS is a little over 5 billion. So even from crude oil receipts alone, could have done twice what we have done with free SHS. But there's nothing beyond that.
Okay.
Because Nanado is here to construct any meaningful infrastructure in this country.
This year is the year of roads.
Please.
Be expectant.
We are even being told by the roads minister that again, by reason of the coronavirus, which I made mention of, the Sinohydro money, and he said this in parliament, that the Sinohydro money is going to have some problems. So these are the clear things on record.
It won't come.
You can deny it.
It won't come.
He's saying that. Look, I have read conversation, I've read research that even shows that this government, that Sino-Hydro butter arrangement, is the most reckless, and we will have our situation where we're unable to even service that particular facility.
Johnny, okay, thank you. Hold on for me. Let Etanam read a few messages.
Right. Yes, let me read a few messages this morning. This one is from Wolanyo in Akwetia. Where have we gone wrong as a nation to experience another mass of death on our roads? If you've ever traveled in a public transport at night before, you'll notice one thing on our roads, abnormal speeding by drivers, since there are few or no cars at all on the roads during that time, midnight and dawn. Again, most drivers who drive at night sleep off whilst driving. This one is, good morning, Johnny. Today, I have enjoyed your program. The MPP man has been factual and educative. I can see the truth in him. Ghana needs people like him. This one is from Musa Abatwa in Kumasi. Johnny, I agree with COPEC for calling the government to reduce fuel prices. They should take the cognitive of the fact that Ghanaians are currently struggling to raise 3 square meals a day. Adding additional burden will be wickedness. They should reduce extravagant taxes on fuel so as the prices of fuel will go down. This one is from Farouk Tamale North. Good morning. It is sad for Ghana. This Kintampo Tamale Road must be looked at. The lives lost day in and day out is disheartening, and government must reduce the fuel price. The world price is down now. This one, it says, now that crude oil prices have been reduced on the world market, we trust the MPA to force the OMCs to reduce the fuel prices. But Ghanaians need NDC. Ghanaians don't need NDC people to tell us about the reduction of fuel prices, because during their time, crude oil price came very low, but they couldn't reduce the prices of fuel in the country. We don't need any hypocritical attitude. This is from Yao Taifa. People, the issue is not about using soap alone, but soap under running water. Tell doctor to demonstrate how hand washing is done. Peter Paul from Nandom. This one says, it's from Al Hassan in Wa. Good morning, Johnny. People, kindly extend my condolence to the family of those who perish on the accident on the Kintampo Road. Johnny, on a more serious note, we need to open more than one door on our long vehicles like VIP, OA, Sky, Imperial, and many more. Opening up doors on both front and back doors can help prevent such huge number of deaths. My regards to Haji Ahumu Awudu, the hope for Wa Central. This one is from Charles Nyame from Asamankese. Asking this MPP government to reduce fuel prices to ease the burden on suffering Ghanaians is like throwing stones at the thigh of elephants. It will definitely hit deaf ears, because they came not for the interests of the people, but for their own family and friends. Happy birthday to Henry Amwako Amwenin of Insawam GRA. This one says, correct score, Zakaria Sunyani. Ghana needs to begin to think ahead. How accidents occur and kill people is bad. To my best knowledge, every point on that stretch, there should be fine tender and police vehicle on the far tender moves together to prevent fatal accidents on our roads. My sincere condolence to the bereaved families. Regards to Charles Akowa, Commissioner Officer Bono Region and Millicent Amankwa. This one says, watching live from MD, respect to the road accidents. With respect to the road accident, I think our laws aren't working and authorities should pay attention to that. The roads can be good, but if our attitudes don't change, we will. We are going to get same result. This one is from Dayuk. This is tips and guides of coronavirus should be more educative to our market women and men. They hold naked monies and later eat food without washing their hands. Thanks. The last one, Johnny, please. All that Dr. Oko is saying is false. Ghanaians' preparedness is zero. Even the president wore a carpenter's nose mask. We are living by the grace of God. This one is from Kwame Kataman, so that's funny.
This is not fair. It's not fair. Thank you.
I mean, how do you say that? How do you say that?
It's not fair. I mean, but I've seen people wear, you know, those masks that are not COVID.
There's a lot of miseducation out there. Even wearing the mask does not necessarily reduce your rate of getting it.
Right.
It's when you are in a high risk area where you have people who have cough or the disease that you have to wear.
I think it's about the unbridled showmanship by our president.
No. I mean, the message clearly is that when you enter, that was a facility where you have, it's a hospital.
But even the mask, we don't have the mask. Look, I asked Dr. Bedu Sako, he says, we have only 5,000 of the PPEs, and we're trying to get 5,000 more.
Yeah.
I mean, I thought it was woefully inadequate.
Yeah.
Even if that was meant for mainline health officials, how many do we have? And if you're in a high-risk area, you use the mask for up to 2-3 hours, you toss it to the bin and bring another one.
My brother Edwiji said, what have we done that has stabilized the city?
Yeah.
If your macroeconomic indicators, if the shape of your economy is bad, you can't have a currency that performs or does well against the dollar. It's very clear. In 2015, our inflation in this country was 17.7%. In 2016, end of 2016, we were doing 15.4%. Today, we are doing around 7.9%. You cannot have an inflation that is trying to approach 20 and have a stable currency. You cannot be spending more than you have. What was the fiscal deficit in this country? We were spending more than we had.
Okay.
Now, let me talk about the debts. In fact,
quickly, our time is up.
Debts are not expressed in absolute terms. You normally express them over to your GDP. Mm. By the way, our nominal amount, total debt in Ghana, was about 122 billion by the time they came in 2008. By the time they left, we were doing how much? Ghana was doing about 214 billion. 12 times what they came to meet.
In 8 years.
12 times, yes, in 8 years. In fact, by the time they were... Yes, I'm coming, please. The add-on was 12 times. That's over 1,200%.
Mm.
We have done about 76% of what the nominal amount, that's the quantum. So you had a percentage of 267% from 2008 to 2012.
Okay, thank you.
You
know,
so,
we've been bailed out.
We are very competent.
We have been bailed out.
We're close to 230 million.
Lawyer Edwiji Tamaklo is the member of the NDC's legal and communications team. Also, Dr. Bernard Okuboy is the board chairman of the Kolebu Teaching Hospital. Is also running one more time for the legal Cuckoo seat. He's the MP, by the way, and we have two ladies contesting him. Doc, you had the vetting already?
Yes.
Okay, it was successful.
Yes.
Okay.
But for the internal
I wish you go back to Parliament for your people.
The internal one.